afternoon, all of you. Today we will discuss about the subcutaneous mycosis. So these are the agents that are responsible for the subcutaneous mycosis. They are usually the inhabitants of the soil. They enter the skin by traumatic inoculation into the contaminated material, and they tend to produce granulomatous lesions into the subcutaneous tissue. So there is always some history of some trauma, injury, or some contact with this soil or some these materials. They are generally chronic, slowly progressive granulomatous infections of the skin and subcutaneous tissue. They are generally present as a swelling, discharging sinuses, and presence of granules in the discharge. Now, these are conditions also called as a Madura mycosis or the Madura foot, because it was described in Madurai, South India, by the John Gill. That's why it is also called as a Madura foot. So, what are the types of the mycoderma or Madura mycosis? So it is mainly responsible, they are mainly of three types: eumycetoma, actinomycetoma, and botryomycosis. Eumycetoma is responsible mainly because of the fungi. Actinomycetoma, that is caused by bacteria, and botryomycosis is generally caused by the bacteria such as Staphylococcus aureus. So these are the organisms that are responsible for the eumycetoma and actinomycetoma. So, as I described, eumycetoma is caused by fungi. So, they are responsible two types of presentation. One is black granules, second one is a white granules. Black granules are seen generally with the Madurella mycetomatis, Madurella grisea, Exophylla ginselmi, and Curvularia species. White granules are generally seen into the Pseudoecerasia boidi, Aspergillus nodulans, Acrimonium species, and Fusarium species. In actinomycetoma, generally granules color are white to yellow. And the responsible agents are Nocardia, that is the most common agent, Streptomyces, Somaliensis, and Actinomadura maduri. And pink to red granules are generally produced by the Actinomadura palliteri. So what are the pathogenic mechanisms? Accidental trauma, like thorn prick or splinter injury, leads to organism enter into the skin or subcutaneous tissue from contaminated soil. Now they form the microabscesses by polymorph and chronic granulomatous tissue in the skin and subcutaneous tissue, and this is a chronic condition. Here you can see in this, as in the picture shown, the clinical triad is seen, that is a tumor like swelling, that is called as tumefaction. Then presence of discharging sinuses. Here you can see there are multiple discharging sinuses seen, and discharges oozing from sinuses that contains the granules. So, by the color of the granules consistency, we can come to know what are the types of the organism it can be responsible. So, commonest site is the feet, osteolytic or osteosclerotic bony lesions are seen, and they are usually painless. So, this clinical trial is suggestive of a mycetoma. Now, how you can differentiate between eumycetoma and actinomycetoma, means fungi origin or the bacterial origin. So tumor, in case of the eumycetoma, tumor is single, well-defined margin, while in actinomycetoma, multiple tumor mass is seen with ill-defined margin. In the eumycetoma, the sinuses appear late, few in number, and while in actinomycetoma, they appear early, numerous, with rays, inflamed opening. Discharge is serous in case of eumycetoma, purulent discharge is seen in case of the actinomycetoma. Grains are generally black and white. In case of actinomycetoma, white or red. Bony lesions are generally osteosclerotic, while in case of actinomycetoma, they are osteolytic. And the grains are containing fungal hyphae, that is more than 2 micrometer in size. In case of actinomycetoma, the filamentous bacteria can be seen. They are less than 2 micrometer in size. So these are the basic differences between eumycetoma and actinomycetoma. If you look at the epidemiology, these are endemic in Africa, India, Central and South America. Globally, it is more common. Actinomycetoma is more common than the eumycetoma. But in India, Rajasthan reports the maximum cases of mycetoma as per year, followed by the Tamil Nadu and West Bengal. Actinomycetoma is predominates everywhere, also in India, but except in Rajasthan, where eumycetoma is more common. So how can we reach to the laboratory diagnosis of this disease? Specimen collection. The grains are collected on sterile gauze piece by pressing the sinuses from periphery or by using a loop. So you have to collect the grains. Now you have to look for the direct examination of the granules. They should be washed into the sterile saline and crushed between the slides and examine. And the macroscopic appearance of the granules should be checked for the color, size, shape, texture. Then after crushing the granules between two slides, you have to go for the KOH mount, Gram staining or modified acid fast staining. These are the stain preparation that you can go for. The KOH mount shows the hyphae. In case of the U-mycetoma, you can see the presence of hyphae, that is 2 to 6 micrometer width, along with chlamydospores at margin. And in case of the actinomycetoma, in KOH you can't find anything, means bacteria cannot be seen into the KOH mount, so you have to go for Gram staining. In Gram stain, you can look for the presence of filamentous Gram positive bacilli, that is 0.5 to 1 micrometer wide, generally Nocardia species. And Nocardia are also seen into the modified acid fast stain, that is a 1% modification of the H2SO4. So it is weakly acid fast, so you can identify the Nocardia by doing modified acid fast stain. These are the histopathological staining of the granules. Here you can see in these granules, these are the cement-like substance in between. These are the texture, these are the granules. Palisade arrangement of the hypha in the cementic substance. And in actinomycetoma, granulomatous reaction with the filamentous bacteria at the margin. These are the filamentous bacteria. Then you have to go for the culture of these granules. Base specimen for culture is granules. Both fungal and bacteriological media you should be used. In fungal media, you should use the Seborrheic dextrose agar. For bacteriological, for Nocardia especially, we use Lowenstein tension medium, blood agar, etc. U-mycetoma agents, they are generally having a late growth. Colony morphology is different. Production of conidia, their sugar assimilation pattern. Other biochemical tests can be done to identify the type of fungi effect involved. In case of the actinomycetoma, you have to check for the growth rate, colony morphology, ureostase, acid fastness, decomposition of media containing casein, tyrosine, xanthine. Okay, so according to type of the presentation or the growth, you have to go for the biochemical reaction for identification. Then, what about the treatment? So, generally, no antibacterial antifungals are generally effective, but generally surgical removal of the lesion should be done to enhance the prognosis of the disease. Antifungal agents can be used, hydroconazole or amphotericin B for 8 to 24 months. Antibiotics can be used such as Wells regimen, that is a amikacin plus cotrimoxazole, that should be used for the actinomycetoma. So that was about the actinomycetoma. It is a type of a subcutaneous mycosis. Now another one is a sporotrichosis. So it is also known as a Rose Gardner's disease. These are the subcutaneous nodular ulcerative lesions. These are caused by generally Sporothrix scanty. These are thermally dimorphic fungi. They grow at two temperatures, at 24 and at 37. That's why they are called as a thermally dimorphic. Now, what about the pathogenesis of this sporotrichosis? So, minor trauma, generally gardeners, those who are working with these plants and flowers and all that, so they generally having the trauma by such a thorn pick or splinter injury. Then spores of this sporotrichosis scanty, they are introduced into the skin. They liberate the fungal enzymes that leads to local invasion. And then they invade the lymphatics and they spread along the course of the lymphatics under the skin. So that leads to the chronic subcutaneous pyogranulomatous disease. Incubation period is about 3 weeks. Lymphocutaneous type is seen. That is the most common type. What you can see is the painless nodular ulcerative lesions along the lymphatic. Along the line of the lymphatics in the skin, you can see the nodular ulcerative lesions and enlarged lymph nodes indurated and have cord-like feeling on palpation. Another clinical types are the osteoarticular type seen among the alcoholics. Pulmonary types are seen following spore inhalation seen into people with COPD. Disseminated sporotrichosis are seen generally into the AIDS patients. And fixed cutaneous types, that is a single nodule is found, that is less progressive and does not spread by the lymphatics. So these are the different presentations of the sporotrichosis. Now one more presentation is a sporotrichoid lymphocutaneous infection. This is a syndrome characterized by the development of superficial cutaneous lesions that progress along dermal and subcutaneous lymphatics. So generally these are the bacteria and fungi, Sporothrix, Nucardia, Mycobacterium marinum, Leishmania brasiliensis. So they can be, it could be any one of these. Rare causes are coccidioides, cryptococcosis, blastomycosis, histoplasmosis, anthrax, Burkholderia, pseudomallei, Lepromatous leprosy, lupus vulgare. So you have to rule out all these things for identification of the causative agent. Epidemiology of this, it is seen in the tropical countries with high humidity, Central South America, South Africa and India. In India, sub Himalayan hilly areas of the Northeast states ranging from Himachal Pradesh to Assam, there it is seen commonly, and other are the northern Karnataka and southern Maharashtra. Source are decaying vegetables, wood, bark, leaves, soils, and people walking barefoot, certain occupations such as farmers and gardeners are commonly affected. So for this sporotrichosis, how can we go for the laboratory diagnosis? So specimens are generally, whatever the nodular ulcerative lesions are there, we have to collect the material from that. If it is pus, aspirate from it, curettage it, and then swab from the ulcer. So these samples can be collected. Direct microscopy of KOH mount or calcofluor staining, that is the fluorescent stains, they can be seen as a elongated yeast cells of 3 to 5 micrometer in diameter. As it is a dimorphic fungi, in the skin specimens you will see only the yeast cells. Histopathological staining of tissue sections, cigar-shaped asteroid bodies can be seen. What is asteroid body? It is a central basophilic yeast cell surrounded by radiating extensions of eosinophilic mass. That is composed of antigen-antibody complexes. It is also called as a Splendor-Hopley phenomenon. So, it is seen, these presentations can be seen into the microscopic sampling. Like you can see the yeast cells and you can see the asteroid body. In the culture, it is a most definitive tool. Specimens are inoculated into SDA and blood agar. In duplicate, incubated at 25 and 37 thia simultaneously because it is dimorphic fungi. So at 25, it will produce the mycelia, means hypha, consisting of slender, delicate hyphae with conidia arranged in a flower-like pattern. This is the presentation seen at the 25 degrees Celsius. And this is the asteroid body, yeast form, that is seen into the direct microscopy examination of specimen. And at 37, it produces a yeast form, characterized by the moist, creamy white colony which turned brown to black within 10 to 14 days. So these two presentations seen at different temperature, that is why they are dimorphic fungi. This is a yeast form seen into the specimen, clinical specimen, and this is a culture at 25. So this is a flower-like sporulation. Serologically, you can go for the latex agglutination test that detects the serum antibodies in patients with extracutaneous form of the disease. Skin test can be done to check the delay type of hypersensitivity reaction against sporotrichin antigen. Treatment, itraconazole is a drug of choice for all form of sporotrichosis. Even in all case of the subcutaneous mycosis, we should use the itraconazole except the disseminated form where amphotericin B is recommended. So it is applied for all the cases of subcutaneous mycosis. Itraconazole is a drug of choice and duration is 2 to 4 weeks after the lesions resolve. Okay, so that was about the sporotrichosis. Now about the chromoblastomycosis. They are slow growing chronic subcutaneous lesions caused by a group of dimeticious or favored fungi, also called as a darkly pigmented fungi, that produces a characteristic morphology called as a sclerotic body. So in that case of the sporotrichosis, that was an asteroid body, this is a sclerotic body. These are the agents of the chromoblastomycosis. These all are dimeticious or phaeoid fungi like Fonsacea pedrosi, Fonsacea compacta, Phyllophora verrucosa, Cladosporium carioni, Rhinocladiella aquaspersa. So these are the agents that could be reason for the chromoblastomycosis. So sclerotic bodies, lesions are generally slow-growing, polymorphic, varicose, crusted, ulcerative and nodular or tumor-like. And the sclerotic bodies are seen as a brown, thick-walled, round cells with a multiple internal transverse septa. So these are called as a sclerotic bodies. Also called as a medullar bodies or muriform cells or copper pennies. So, these are the different names given to this presentation. They are generally seen in subtropical or tropical climates, often in rural areas. And treatments are surgical removal, cryosurgery or laser therapy of the lesions, followed by antifungus. As I told you, it is itraconazole. That is the drug of choice for subcutaneous mycosis. Now another one presentation lesions are pheohyphomycosis. These are chronic subcutaneous lesions caused by nematicious or phaeoid fungi other than that are described in chromoblastomycosis. That they do not produce sclerotic bodies. So this is the difference between these two. Chromoblastomycosis, they produce sclerotic bodies. Here in pheohyphomycosis, they do not produce sclerotic bodies. And they generally exist into the mycelial form. They are caused by Alternaria species, Bipolaris, Corbularia, Exophylla, Ginselmi, Cladophyllophora, Bentiana. So these are the present, these are the agents that are responsible for the pheohyphomycosis. So another one is the rhinosporidiosis. The treatment of choice is same, the itraconazole and excision surgical removal of the lesion. In rhinosporidiosis, you must be heard of it. It is a chronic granulomatous disease characterized by large friable polyps in the nose, conjunctiva, and occasionally into the ears, larynx, bronchus, and genitalia. Agents are Rhinosporidium sieberi. It is an aquatic protistan parasite that is responsible. It is generally seen, acquired from the stagnant water, and distribution is generally into the tropical countries, especially Sri Lanka, India. It is more common into the India. So they are present as a large friable polyps into the nose. The rhinosporidiosis, the diagnosis can be done by histopathology of the polyps. Here you can see these are the spherules. Large spherules that are seen into the histopathological section of this nose polyp. They are large sporangia up to 350 micrometer size that contain the numerous endospores, each 6 to 9 micrometer in size. So there are inside, there will be presence of endospores. They are stained better with mucicarmine stain, and it is not cultivable till now. So the culture is not possible. Treatment is generally a surgery. Radical surgery with cauterization is a mainstay of treatment, but the recurrence is very common. The dapsone can be given for the remaining amount of agents. Okay, so these were about the rhinosporidiosis. So this completes your subcutaneous mycosis. In this lecture, we have discussed about the mycetoma, medulla mycosis, then sporotrichosis, then chromoblastomycosis, then pheohyphomycosis, and rhinosporidiosis. So we can go for the MCQ. Chromoblastomycosis is caused by this, any of this. This is exophylla. Which of the following organism is not been isolated in artificial culture media? So it is, the answer is Rhinosporidium sieberi. Asteroid bodies are observed into the sporotrichosis. Barrel-shaped arthroconidia is seen into the coccidio. So it is of a deep mycosis. Sclerotic bodies are seen into the chromoblastomycosis. Chicle-shaped large macroconidia is seen into the fusarium species. The cyst resemble crushed ping pong balls is seen in case of the pneumocystis zero vacae. Okay, so this was.